processional hymn 383.
Jesus, Christ, for today are for the feast of St. Michael and all ages. The Lord be with you.
And
let us pray, eternal God, you have ordained and constituted in a wonderful order the ministries of angels and warriors. Grant that as your holy angels stand before you in heaven, so at your command they may help and defend us here on earth. In Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please sit for the readings.
A reading from the book of Genesis. Jacob left Beersheba and went into Haran. He came back to a certain place and stayed there for the night. Because the sun had set, taking one of the stones of the cross, he put it under his head and lay down in that place. And he dreamed that there was a ladder set up from the earth, the top of it reaching heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending. And the Lord stood beside him and said, I am the Lord, the God of Abraham, your father, and God of Isaac. The land on which you lie, I will give to you, to your offspring, and your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth. And you shall spread abroad to the west and to the east, and to the north and to the south. And all the families of the earth shall be blessed in you, and in your offspring. Know that I am with you, and will keep you wherever you go, and will bring you back to this land, for I shall not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Then Jacob woke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place. I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how also is this place? This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
By the word of their testimony, for they did not cling to life even in the face of death.
Rejoice then, you heavens and those who dwell in them. But woe to the earth and the sea, for the devil has come down to you with great wrath, because he knows that his time is short. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Very, very ancient times. And for reasons that I'm not now become separated from the original reason. It's also a feast day that's attached to a lot of food things. I know, I'm getting excited about life. It's perfect for that. So the first thing, there's kind of like a good news, bad news thing I have to tell you. If you're having goose for dinner today, you will have no more money problems for the rest of the year. Anybody got that goose? Excellent, my friend, excellent. So if you don't have a goose today, you're in for some severe money issues. So you might want to run out to the farmer's market right after service today, see what you can do. Comes from a very ancient tradition that at this time of the year, at the turning of the year in the fall, in the Middle Ages, it was common for landowners to appoint a reeve over their servants, their peasants, their slaves. And this was a time in which rents were collected. And most times those rents were paid with goose or other livestock. Also, today is the last day that you may collect or eat blackberries. Because legend has it that when Satan fell from heaven, he fell right into a blackberry bush. And so from that day onwards, he will curse and cause to go moldy every blackberry since that day. So today maybe is your last opportunity to make that fruit tart to eat those blackberries. For reasons that we don't know, it's a day that's also associated with ginger. In Italy particularly, people eat ginger snaps, ginger rolls, ginger spreads. We're not sure. We've lost that connection. It's a day of kind of bizarre traditions, but there we have it. It's also a day in which people felt that illnesses came to an end. It was felt that it was a day of climate changing over to the fall season, regardless of what the temperature was. I've observed that. You see, I've given up my sandals finally into the closed toe shoes. The traditions and the superstitions, if I can say that, persist even now. If you were living in Scotland today, you'd be baking a particular kind of bannock. If you were living in Ireland, you'd be preparing a Michaelmas pie. Most schools, certainly my seminary, consider this not the beginning of school, but the Michaelmas term. So it's an important time, not just in the life of the church, but it has seeped into the secular life as well. St. Michael is seen as a great saint, an important saint, as we heard in the Gospel and more particularly in the epistle reading, or the Revelation of John. He is seen as the great overthrower of Satan as an angel who lived in heaven and was thrown out because he couldn't quite keep the peace. And so he's depicted popularly. I was going to bring you my sweatshirt today, but I wear it to walk the dogs, and it's looking a bit muggy, so I decided not to bring it in. But my second parish was St. Michael the Archangel, and we had made these sweatshirts, and St. Michael on it is depicted looking extremely muscular. I had to ask the artist to tone it down a bit. He's looking like, sort of like Charles, no, it's not Charles, what's his name? Arnold Schwarzenegger. He's looking very Arnold. But he's often depicted looking very muscular, very warrior-like, large feathered wings, spear in hand, and often with his foot on Satan or on a dragon or something similar. And interestingly enough, if you look at many of the ancient pictures of St. Michael, you'll also see blackberries somewhere in that stained glass or in those triptychs. It's hidden if you look. The concept of St. Michael as an angel is of a warrior-like, fierce, important heavenly power. Much like many of the crazy food and other superstitions around St. Michael have become separated from the truth, our concept of angels has become greatly separated from the biblical picture and characterization that we see in a couple of our readings today. Angels have become almost cult-like for many people in our society. They are everywhere. But they're not the warrior-like, spear-holding, Satan-attacking creatures that St. Michael represents. We see them in cute little chubby cherubs. You see them everywhere. You see them in cards, in pictures, in artwork, on chocolate boxes, in jewelry, on t-shirts, in people's cars, and often given away as little pins. But the separation between who an angel really is and how our society perceives them is great. And I think that some people who have difficulty in coming to grips in a relationship with God find it easier to have a relationship or think about a theology that involves angels because they're cute, cherub-like nature. They think about my guardian angel. They see the angel as their intercessor, perhaps between good and bad. And in fact, that is the grain of truth in that kind of thinking, because we see distinctly in these readings that angels are the intercessors between heaven and earth. They're a strong messenger between heaven and earth. We look at Jacob today. Jacob is on the run. He's fleeing because he has literally fleeced, see what I did there? Fleeced his brother. It was his brother,
Esau.
Very good, Esau. And what did he do to Esau? He cheated him out of his birthright. How? He put a fleece on himself and went to his father, who was blind, and the father thought that he was Esau, so he gave him his birthright. So he is, hence the saying, he has fleeced his brother. He's on the run. He can never go home again. He doesn't even know where he's going to go. And he finds himself in the middle of nowhere with a stone for his pillow. So he lies down and he has a dream. And he sees angels ascending and descending on a ladder, a connection for him between heaven and earth. Jacob, who sees himself as irredeemable at this point. And he wakes up and he comes to an understanding. Surely God is in this place. And then he hears a strong message from God. I am with you always. Not only that, he suddenly is going to become the father of a great nation, great descendants. So he has gone from a man on the run with no home and nowhere to go to someone who is suddenly favored by God, despite what many would consider an unforgivable sin. These angels have brought him a message and become his bridge back to God. So for Jacob in his understanding, there is redemption. There is a way back. He gets that message from these important messengers of God. And then we come to Nathanael, a man whom we're told had no God, an innocent, open, receptive Israelite who is interested to know what his future held. And he comes into contact with Jesus through a friend. And he thinks, how does this man know my name? How does he know who I am? I haven't met him before. Jesus says to him, do you think this is amazing? You will see greater things. You will see, as Jacob saw, as your ancestors saw, angels ascending and descending from heaven, pulling us together, but not by a ladder, by Jesus himself. Jesus has become the great mediator between heaven and earth. Jesus is our mediator between heaven and earth. Not chubby little angels, but Jesus, having taken on human flesh, can be that bridge between the earthly and the heavenly, the sinful and the perfect. And mediation, the great mediator, is not a magic trick. It's a drawing together of disparate parties, of disparate situations. I was in a mediation on Friday all day long. Four parties. trying to come to an agreement. Four parties with very different interests. And we sat there, and one person had the very difficult job of helping us to come to a resolution. And I was amazed as I watched how skillfully he took four different groups of people, all with very different desires, very different interests, very different hopes for very different outcomes, and skillfully, slowly, drew us together. By going to each party individually, showing them where common ground was available, showing them where better options were available, showing them where they could come to a resolution in which each party felt not crushed, not left aside, not out of hope for anything, but rather supported and included and brought back into relationship with those from whom they were estranged. He skillfully went back and forth, up and down, a word here, a word there, a suggestion here, a suggestion there, a possibility here, a reframing of words, carefully drawing people back together. It was a long day. It was an exhausting day. But at the end, people who were in the middle of very intense litigation went around and hugged one another. Jesus is that kind of mediator for us. He is that mediator between us and God. Jesus who brings us back together in right relationship with God. Not chubby little cherubs, not a blackberry pie, not some gooseberries or blackberries, lymphatic or anything else. On this day, we celebrate that Jesus, the Son of Man, will cause us to see greater things than we can imagine. We will see heaven and earth skillfully, carefully, timelessly brought together into one whole. What an awesome place this is, Jesus says. Surely the Lord is in this place. Amen. Our response to God's presence with us in his words is in our confession of faith, in the words of the Apostles' Creed on page 189. Let us confess the faith of our baptism as we say,
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, the only Son of our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again.
And for the United Moment. the worldwide name continue. We pray for the people and clergy of the Episcopal Church of America, and presiding Bishop Michael Curry, and the Diocese of Toronto. We pray for the Primate's World Relief and Development Fund, and our own parish cycle of prayer. We pray for Robin and Steve, Linus and Holly Peasgood, and Mara and Peter Rhodes. Merciful Lord, we pray for all who call themselves Christians, that we may become a royal priesthood, a holy nation to the praise of Christ Jesus, our Savior.
Lord, hear and have mercy.
We pray for all those whose lives are bound in mutual love, and all those who live in celibacy. Be their joy and their strength.
Lord, hear and have mercy.
We pray for Michael Calvary, Michael Stabler, for all in danger, those far from home, prisoners, exiles, victims of oppression. Grant them your salvation.
Lord, hear and have mercy.
We pray for all who are facing trials and difficulties, for the sick, remembering especially Angela, Bill, John Bentley, Hillary, Joan, Lucy, Nanette, Christopher Franklin, Debbie White, Rita Vine, Logan, Aaron, David, Ryan, and many others known to us. And we pray for those who are dying. Show them your kindness and mercy.
Lord, hear and have mercy.
We pray for one another. May we always be united in service and love.
Lord, hear and have mercy.
We pray to be forgiven of our sins and set free from all hardship, distress, want, war, and injustice.
Lord, hear and have mercy.
In our prayers for the world, we remember those who are running for public office in the upcoming federal election. We pray for the protesters in Hong Kong who have renewed their protests today, striving for democracy in that country. We pray for the courage and conviction of those protesting around the world for climate change awareness. May we discover new and just ways of sharing the goods of the earth, struggling against exploitation, greed, or lack of concern. May we all live by the abundance of your mercies and find joy together.
Lord, hear and have mercy.
May we be strengthened by our communion with all Christ's saints.
Lord, hear and have mercy.
Gracious God, you have heard the prayers of your faithful people. In our needs before we ask, in our ignorance and asking, grant our requests as may be best for us. This we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
We continue on page 191. Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites us to his table. Let us confess our sins confidently in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may be your life and your will, and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Jesus Christ said to his disciples, "My peace I give to you, my peace I leave with you. Not as the world gives, give I unto you. The peace of the Lord be always with you."
And also with you. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, we praise you.
in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil, and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, a death he freely accepted, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, Father, according to his command,
we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory.
And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament to the body of Christ, and his blood the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in the sacrifice, that we may be acceptable in him and sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, reconcile all things in Christ to make them new, and bring us to that city of light where you dwell with all your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray, our Father in heaven.
Hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Send us for the fraction. Sentence number 4. I am the bread which has come down from heaven, says the Lord.
Give us this bread forever.
I am the vine. You are the branches.
You may dwell in him as he lives in us.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are they who are called to his supper, the gifts of God for the people of God.
Lord,
with the bread of angels. May we who come under their protection, like them, give you continual service and praise. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
We conclude with the prayer at the bottom of page 214. All your works praise you, O Lord.
And your things are served and blessed. Gracious God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. May we share his body, live his risen life. We who drink his cup, bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights, give life to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so that we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Be steadfast in faith, joyful in hope, and untiring in love all the days of your life. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and those you love, here and in paradise, now and forever.
Amen.
Announcements. Kirk, any of you have a move to say this morning? No? Okay. All right. So, a reminder that if you have a subscription to the Annual Journal and you wish to continue that subscription, please go online and confirm that. You will see the way to do it via a little note on the bulletin board. The deadline is October 31st. It's a free publication. It's just that both the dioceses of the National Church are sensitive to our environment and don't wish to be sending out a load of paper to addresses that are no longer valid or to people who don't wish to receive it. So in order to be conscious of that, they're asking those people who really have an interest in receiving the publication, of course it's available online as well, to let them know that. So please take note. Our friends at Habitat for Humanity are doing a build in Orangeville. If you are interested in getting involved, the details are also on the bulletin board. Our local hospital, Headwaters, is looking for lay volunteers who might be interested in joining the chaplaincy team. So if you think you might have a call to pastoral visiting, obviously there's training involved. And please call Barbara at the hospital and she can give you more details. Also a reminder, our brothers and sisters at Samaras today are holding a very interesting event. The details are here. They're also in the parish hall. It's sponsored by the Indigenous Awareness Group. And there's a light lunch and the presentation from Dr. Wesley Swine. Next Sunday is Harvest Sunday. Not Thanksgiving, that's the following Sunday. It's Harvest. So we will be celebrating Harvest. Remember to bring all of your donations for the Orangeville Food Bank. I expect to see a massive pile. The list of what is preferred is contained in your bulletin, and you can make yourself aware of that. So please be generous as we celebrate God's gift and bounty to all of us, which not all of us are privileged to share. We have calendars coming for next year, the famous Anglican Church calendar, so beloved by so many people. They've been ordered, say no more. Also, the way outside is our forward day by day, either the small pamphlet or the large print, also free. If you'd like to take them, they're a wonderful page. I use them every morning in my prayers, and they're a wonderful little devotional if you are interested. And our Bible study is starting October 29th. I know it's far, far in the future, but it's coming faster than you think. The topic will be abiding in Christ. We're going to look at a very small section of John's Gospel. And the guides have been ordered, and once they arrive, if you have signed up or you are interested, they will be made available. Are there any other announcements? Oh, yes, how could I forget? As you heard last week, we are going to be coming involved with a community garden, and we will be setting up plots here at the church for people in Orangeville who may not have access to a garden to plant what they would like to plant. No, we are not a recognized cannabis site. I'm sorry if that's what you are hoping for. That's off the table. I know many people have inquired, and I've had to say no. So, I'm not naming names. I'm simply suggesting that we are licensed for that. Please let us know. It's being spearheaded by Hugh and Elsie, who've done this many times in their previous parish, are bringing us a wealth of knowledge and experience. It's not something that happens by itself, though, so if you would like to volunteer to help, you don't have to dig or plant anything. That will be done by the individuals who decide to rent the plots. We're going to do one plot, which will be growing solely for the benefit of the Orchard Food Bank, so that they can have some fresh produce. If you could donate old gardening tools that you just don't use anymore, that would be helpful. Or if you could just volunteer to be on site once the gardens are up and running in the spring, just as a resource and someone helpful, that would be delightful. So if you want any more information, speak to Hugh and Elsie at coffee hour. They know the whole routine, they've done it many times, and they've got it down to a fine science. So it's a wonderful initiative that we're hoping to pursue for St. John's and for our greater community. Also, something important is coming up in the life of our nation. October 21st is Election Day. We will be a polling station, and we will be open from very early in the morning till about midnight that day. The polls close at 9:30, apparently, and they're counting right here. So, if you could volunteer some time, we're hoping to keep tea and coffee available for all those who are working for Elections Canada. If you could volunteer some time, we're interested in helping. Speak to the church wardens, and that would be a wonderful thing. We'll be doing this setup for the day, the Sunday after Mass, so perhaps you could keep that in mind and help with that. Are there any other announcements? Yes, Susan.
Tomorrow, Monday, September the 30th, is Orange Shirt Day. So if anybody, it's to do with the residential schools, so if you can support and wear orange is one of my favorite colors, even though where I work, I'm going to wear it anyways.
Orange is the new black.
Yes.
That's a reference to where Susan works.
So I am going to support it, so if anybody has orange and is willing to wear it, please support the residential schools.
Yes. Can I ask what does that mean, to support the residential schools?
It's for those who have been victims in the school. So we are supporting...
I didn't know if there were some other residential schools.
No, for the residential schools.
It's for the survivors of residential schools and that legacy.
And the Anglican Church, there is, they're talking about it also on their website as well. So the Anglican Church does support. So if anyone else can support it, please do so.
Any other announcements? Jim Potter has a very important announcement.
Yes, we did. I got up early yesterday morning, and I picked up Greg, and we drove together to Schaumburg, where there was the annual running of the Schaumburg Country Run. We did the full 5 kilometers, maybe not in the best time, but we did it anyway. And between the two of us, I'm very pleased to say, with a great deal of support from this congregation, but from other people as well, $1,705. Greg has put some photographs on the Facebook page for St. John's. I'm sure if you went there, you'd see how happy we were. Before and after. So there you go. Thanks so much, everybody, for supporting this great cause. And if you don't remember what the cause is, it's to help bring potable water to the houses in Mechanicum in northern Ontario. They've been going along with water from going to the well to pick up a bucket of water every day. Now we're going to pipe it to them with the help that you have provided for these many years. I think I've been running this project since 2011, and I'm very pleased to say to you that I'll keep on doing it until I drop.
Hopefully not during the race. If you didn't get a chance to support Jim or Greg, but still wish to, I'm sure you'd welcome your donation after Mass. Anybody else going once, going twice? Please join your brothers and sisters next door in the church hall for some tea, coffee, or other refreshments. Say hello to someone you haven't spoken to before and see if you have a safe and blessed week.